It has been such a privilege to be a parent. I have learned so much about life ever since I've had children born. I had no idea. I have read books upon books upon books about parenting. I have read books upon books about children. And then I got a couple, and it's like everything I read was right, but everything I read was so missing some major issues. And I'll hear things from people. I'll hear things, and then I've experienced it. And it's so bizarre to me. For example, I have found being a father that I have to repeat myself. And I have to repeat myself a lot, like over and over and over again. Like just not that long ago, I was wanting to get my daughter's attention. She's on her iPad. And I don't know what it is about modern day technology and children, but they zone right into that, right? And so my daughter's on her iPad, she's playing, and I go up and I go, "Hey, Ziva." And she just, not a blink, not a any registering that she's even heard me, right? I go, "Hey, Ziva." She just, still going. So I go, "Ziva, daddy's talking to you." Still nothing. So I decide I'm gonna take a different approach. I lean down to her, kid you not, I did this. I leaned right up to her and I went, "Ziva, Ziva, 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 Ziva." I'm just going on. And you know what she's doing? Her eyes are getting wide and she's swiping faster and she's, you know, doing this. I'm Ziva, 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 Ziva. And she's like, finally, she just puts it down and goes, "What?" You know, and there are other times where I have to repeat myself differently. "Ziva, get socks and shoes on. We're going to go to the store." And she's still watching TV, playing with a toy, or on her iPad, or whatever's going on. I come back a couple minutes later. Her feet are still bare, still barefoot. And I go, "Ziva, socks, shoes, we're going to the store." And then I leave. I come back a few minutes later. She's still barefoot. And I go, "Ziva, socks and shoes." She goes, "You get them." "Ziva, get your socks and shoes, or you're not going to the store with daddy and you're going to stay here." And her eyes got wide and she got up and she runs and comes back with her socks. Actually, she runs. She comes back wearing sandals. And I look at her. She goes, "I don't have to wear socks. I'm wearing sandals." Yes, you're right. So there are times I'm finding myself having to repeat over. I'm noticing other parents, same thing. Yeah. Why are wives saying, "Yeah, my husband, I got to repeat myself 100 times for him." Okay, now, there are also times I will repeat myself on purpose. Not because she is ignoring, not because she's not paying attention, not because she's distracted, but because I just want to say it over and over again anyways. And those are things I want her to never forget. So I make sure that every day, a minimum of one time, but usually about a dozen times, I end up telling my daughter and my son, "I love you," and I kiss them on the forehead, and I tell them, "God loves you," every day. Every day they get that I love them and God loves them. Why? Because I don't want them to forget, ever. So every day I tell them that. Every day. And I want to make sure that it stays that way until I die. That's one of my goals, is to tell them every day, "I love you. God loves you." And so I just that repetition. Well, here's what we find within Scripture, and that is that there is oftentimes repetition. Yes, the Bible is God's word, and it's there, and you can read it over and over and over again. We can read it repetitiously. We can read the same thing as many times as we want. However, there are also times where the Bible itself literally repeats itself over several chapters or even several books. Like, for example, how many times does the Bible repeat about the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus? We have at least four Gospels, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, besides the fact Paul seemingly to say that phrase in every one of his letters just about. He says, "Jesus resurrected, Jesus crucified," and whatever. But we get that constant repetition. Why? Because God does not want us to forget that Jesus lived, Jesus died, Jesus rose again. That's kind of a very important part. Okay, so there's lots of repetition in the Bible. One of the repetitions that we're about to see today is the vision of Peter, where Peter had the vision. Remember about the giant divine picnic, right? A big old blanket came from the sky and it was filled with every unclean animal. And God says, Peter, eat. And Peter goes, oh no, I would never eat anything unclean. And then God says, Peter, eat. And three times they went through that because, you know, Peter has those types of habits. Okay, and so he went through that. And then later, Peter told briefly the vision and the interpretation of the vision at the end of chapter 10 when he was talking to Cornelius about what he had seen. Now in chapter 11, we get the entire vision again. Every detail, all the way down to the animals, all the way down to the vision, all the way down to the three repetitions. We get a repetition yet again. Why? Because we are like kids. Because we are all like children. We get distracted. We forget. We get so wrapped up in our own things that we don't pay attention. Sometimes we simply and completely reject and disobey. And honestly, sometimes we're just stubborn or ignorant. And we just don't get it the first time. Or the second time, for that matter. Okay, and we need repetition. And so there's something so vital here about this vision of Peter that deserves to be repeated again, and it doesn't even wait that long. We go from chapter 10 to chapter 11 just to get it again. So let's look into this a little bit. Peter's going to go back over to Jerusalem, and the Jews are going to be ticked off at Peter. They're going to be offended, so he's going to have to defend himself, and he does so by sharing the vision that God gave him regarding his visit to Cornelius in chapter 10. Okay, so here's what goes on here. Chapter 11, starting at verse 1. The apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles had welcomed God's message. When Peter went up to Jerusalem, those who stressed circumcision, in other words, they're very dedicated Jews, okay? Even if they're Christian Jews, they're still very dedicated to the law. So they stressed circumcision and they argued with Peter saying, "You visited uncircumcised men and if that wasn't enough, you ate with them." Oh. Okay, let's pause here for a brief moment. You visited them, shame on you, and you ate with them. Okay, I mean, you would think that he went to a country concert or something. I mean, it was just a horrible thing that they were just so upset about. You know, and so they were just like, what are you? And of course, it can be questioned. Why? Never in the Old Testament do we really see this whole anti-Gentile, like of this nature, like this. Not necessarily. People point to a lot of places. So why was this so sinful to actually visit with a Gentile like that? And here's the reason. Gentiles do not follow the law, right? Because they're not Jews. They're not part of the Abrahamic covenant. They're not part of the Mosaic covenant. They're not part of the Davidic covenant. They don't follow the law because they're Gentiles. And if a Gentile were to follow the law completely, they become Jew. Of Jew by religion, not nationality, but they're considered Jew. Okay, and so why are they frustrated? Because Gentiles don't follow the law. Therefore, Gentiles are considered technically unclean. They might have touched a dead body and don't care. They might have put bacon bits in your salad and you didn't know it. Okay, they might have, you know, and now you're going to be eating pork, which is unclean. Okay, and so they might have fixed you food that might have cross-contamination and you would be ignorant. And then you would come to the temple ritualistically unclean. And what tends to happen during worship services in the Old Testament when somebody goes to the temple unclean? God shows up with punishment, and ignorance is not an excuse. Okay, I don't care if you don't know what the speed limit is. You still broke the speed limit, and you're guilty. Here's a ticket. Congratulations. Okay, so God has done that in the Old Testament in the past. So therefore, a lot of the religious leaders of the Judaistic religion would say, don't even visit with Gentiles. Don't eat at their house. Have nothing to do with them. Heaven forbid you get ignorantly unclean, ritualistically speaking, and then you show up at the temple. So you see that they're at least They have a semi-potential plausible reason, albeit stupid, okay? But they have a plausible reason. It makes sense to a degree, but they take it too far because now the mission of Israel as a witness is lost because that means they're only witnessing to Jews, okay? So that's kind of where they're at. Now, we kind of have a little bit of this problem today. We really do. And not only do we have racial divides that are going on, I think even bigger than that, we have political divides. We have the whole conservative, liberal, pro-gay marriage, not pro-gay marriage, pro-choice, pro-life, Republican, Democrat, libertarian, that at least the Republican and Democrats have a common enemy there, and on, the problems just arise all over the place. We have a lot of issues, and we have some people that will even go so far as to say, I refuse to associate with that person whatsoever. And we have other ways, more subtle, like the people that we don't want to give eye contact to when we're driving because they're on the edge of the street with a cardboard sign. And so we don't even look at them. We look the other direction. Or maybe we get a call on our cell phone and we see who it is and we thank God for straight to voicemail. And we know who those people are that we just don't want to be caught dead with. We just don't want to associate with. We just don't want to take the time for. And what we have to eventually learn to do is to be able to say, man, we got to speak grace into these people's lives. And if it's not us, then whom? Because we're the one that has the contact. But we find ourselves potentially very similar to how the religious leaders are, those emphasizing a circumcision. I know of several churches, I've had actually talked to some of my pastor friends that have been kicked out of church associations because they associated with the church that had a different doctrinal stance on issues. I had one pastor friend in Grand Rapids here. He was kicked out of the General Association of Regular Baptists because his youth team had a volleyball match with a Southern Baptist church or a Southern Baptist plant or something, or some other Baptist denomination. I thought it was SBC, might be a different Baptist denomination. And they said, you know what? If you're going to do that, you can't be part of GARB anymore. And they kicked him right out. And now they're completely unassociated with that because they talked with someone else that was of a different stance on whatever issue. And so we find that type of divide all the time. Several denominations will even create doctrinal standpoints just so that they won't be confused with one of those other ones. One of the reasons why Baptists don't talk about the Holy Spirit too much. We would hate to be associated with those crazy people, those hyper-charismaniacs that swing from the chandeliers and always preach with a white hanky and a cordless mic. You know, we don't want to be associated with that, so we're not going to talk about the Holy Spirit. Besides, if we talk about the Holy Spirit too much, we might have to get into issues of healings and miracles, and that just makes us uncomfortable, and that goes, we can't have that. And so there's that type of divide that exists within even the church of today. And so we get this wonderful little moment here where Peter's talking with someone from a different standpoint on issues, and now the leaders are upset. They're upset. So here's what Peter ends up doing in verse 4. He says, Peter began to explain to them in an orderly sequence. You got to love that. Okay, Peter really keeps a chronology here. He's trying to really defend himself appropriately. And he says, I was in the town of Joppa praying. I'm a good Jew. I was praying. Okay, so it's just like when somebody has an idea, they want to sound pious. They say, you know, one day while I was praying, God said to me, and then they come up with their idea. Okay, it's that type of a thing. So Peter's like, so I was praying and I saw in a visionary state. So in other words, God gave me a vision. So in a visionary state, an object that resembled a large sheet coming down, being lowered by its four corners from heaven, and it came to me. And when I looked closely and considered it, okay, I looked curiously upon this event, right? And I considered it. I saw the four-footed animals of the earth, the wild beasts, the reptiles, and the birds of the sky. Then I also heard a voice telling me, get up, Peter, kill and eat. No, Lord, I said. Why is Peter saying this? Because the other Jews would be like, oh, well, don't worry. I said, no, God. And they're like, oh, he passed the test. Peter passed the test. He's a good Jew. Okay, so he's pouring this all out so they can experience what he experienced vicariously here. So I know, Lord, I said, for nothing common or ritually unclean has ever entered my mouth. Okay, so he's being very clear. I'm a good Jew like you guys, okay? We're not that different here. I get the concern of this. So nothing has ever entered my mouth. But, gotta love butts. I know tills are nice, but butts are better. Okay, but a voice answered from heaven a second time. What God has made clean, you must not call common. Now, this happened three times. I applaud Peter for sharing that fact. Okay, I do. I applaud Peter for saying, man, I struggled with this for a while. How transparent of him. This happened three times. And then everything was drawn up again into heaven. At that very moment, three men who had been sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. Then the Spirit told me to accompany them with no doubts at all. These six brothers, yeah, I love it. These six brothers, now how many came to him? How many brothers went with him? Where did the other three come from? Remember, he brought with him three witnesses. Okay, so when Peter, you go back to chapter 11, he brought three with him. So you got Peter and now six guys. Okay, so he's like, so these six brothers accompanied me. Part of me wonder if they might have traveled with him. And he's actually showing them, these guys right here, these six. I wonder that. It's interesting to think about. But these six brothers accompanied me, and we went into the man's house. He reported to us how he had seen an angel standing in his house and saying, send to Joppa, call for Simon, who is also named Peter. He will speak a message to you that you and all your household will be saved by. Remember, I had mentioned Cornelius was not saved, even though he was a righteous man. Even though he was a good man, a moral man, an ethical man, even though he was a God-fearing man, he was not saved because he did not have Jesus. And in verse 44, he got saved. And in case you wanted an interpretation that concluded that same argument, right here. He does not get saved until he gets the message about Jesus. Okay, so Peter will come and speak to you a message and all your household will be saved by. As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came down on them just as on us at the beginning. So he's telling them, remember how we had this moment? We called it, you know, the moment that happened at Pentecost. Pentecost is this annual celebration that always is taking place. It means 50 days after Passover. At this one particular Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came upon us, descended on us like tongues of fire, and great things started happening. Well, guess what? It happened there too with Gentiles. Okay, so he said it came down upon them just as on us at the beginning. Then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John baptized with water, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Okay, so it shows that prophecy of John the Baptist had been fulfilled and fulfilled yet again with the Gentiles. Therefore, if God gave them the same gift that he also gave to us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, how could I possibly hinder God? When they heard this, they became silent. Gotta love that. They just got caught dead in their tracks. They just went, oh. You know, they just, wow, really? This is what's happening. We had heard this, but wow, knowing the whole story, wow, they were speechless. Then, after some silence, they glorified God, saying, so God has granted repentance resulting in life even to the Gentiles. Now, I don't want you to hear this as sarcasm. Oh, great, so now God has granted life even to the Gentiles. Well, there goes the church. Okay, it's not a sarcastic type statement. Okay, this is really sincere praise because it even says they glorified God, not spoke in some angry, gruff, but accepting, tolerating manner. Okay, they're honestly glorifying God. So God has granted repentance resulting in life. Man, he's even reaching the Gentiles, and we thought they were unreachable. We thought that was never going to happen. And God has exceeded all of our expectations. And I don't know if how many of us struggle with the idea of an unreachable person. And I know some people that are married to atheists, married to Wiccans, married to different forms of pagantry, and sometimes they feel like, this person will never come around. Sometimes they feel like this is never going to happen, or they have coworkers or a boss, or they know of enemies on this planet, evil men, and they say, this is never, they're beyond hope. It's beyond reach. And it's neat to see that God is not so limited as that, that he can reach anyone. There is always hope as long as there's life in the person. And so it's neat to be able to see that. And so what we end up seeing now is that as this is developing, and now the mission to the Gentiles is becoming front focus, what's the rest of the church doing? What's happening amongst the church besides just in Peter's corner? And that's what we see a little glimpse of in verses 19 to 21, where it says this: those who had been scattered as a result of the persecution that started because of Stephen made their way as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, Antioch, speaking the message to no one except Jews. That's interesting. But, isn't that better than till? Okay, but there were some of them, Cypriot and Cyrenian men, who came to Antioch and began speaking to the Hellenists, began speaking to Greek people. Okay, they began speaking to Hellenists, proclaiming the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hands was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. Okay, so what we find here is that We get a little bit of a recap. We're going to see this verse, those verses in more detail in 11 weeks when we come back to Acts again in chapter 12 after we do our little Esther excursion. Okay, so we'll see this as a great recap and continuing on that recap from there. But what's happening is that people are reaching, some are reaching just the Jews. They're reaching the ones that are just like them. They dress like them. They look like them. They smell like them. They work in jobs like them. They drive cars like them. They didn't have cars, so they rode camels like them. Whatever the case may be, they were very much like them. Same interests, same attitude, same look, same demeanor, same demographic. Okay, and that there were some that were willing to not be so limited, not be so short-sighted. Some that were willing to say, I don't care if their hair looks funny. I don't care if they walk funny. I don't care if they dress funny. I don't care if their skin's a different color. I don't care if they're homeless or if they're rich. I don't care if they're pagan or if they're whatever. I don't care. I'm going to reach them with Jesus anyway. Okay, there were some that was like that, and they went to the Greek-speaking people. They weren't stuck with just the Jews. And it is awesome that they did that, that they preached that way as well. And so what we get then is a triple repetition. Peter gets a vision that says God wants anyone and everyone. He ends up giving the interpretation to that vision. Then in chapter 11, he gives it again. Here's the vision. The message is God wants everyone and anyone. And then we get in the recap part there in verse 19 through 21, we get some were doing just the Jews, but some were figuring out how to reach anyone and everyone. So what's the repetitious manner there? We are to try to reach everyone and anyone, okay? That we aren't supposed to be limited to people that are just like us. And I know that sometimes we struggle with that because when visitors come in from time to time and we look at them and we look at how they dress and we look at where they work and the type of income they have and the interest they have, and we sometimes might say, boy, I hope they join the church and they come again because that's the type of people we need. And I know we feel that way because I've heard it said. And sometimes I've even thought it. I've had it in my head before. Why? Because someone will come in and I'll say, oh, here's someone that could lead this ministry. Here's someone that could develop this youth ministry in a different, here's someone if they would only, and I tend to think of it strategically, but can't a lost person get saved and then over time be discipled and become the person the church needs to be able to lead certain ministries? So can't really just about anybody that walks through the doors have that potential? Isn't the people that we bump into at the store able to potentially be that person? Not right away, because you don't want new converts into positions of leadership. They have to grow and disciple, and they have to, you know, jump through various hoops as appropriate. At the same time, couldn't that person fit that bill? Couldn't that happen? Absolutely. But we tend to just want what we're looking for. We just want something simple and plain. And what we need to be able to do is to reach people regardless of demographic. But how do we do that? Because I don't know about you, but it's a struggle. It's a struggle to try to reach people. It's a struggle to try to, if you will, live an evangelistic lifestyle. Because that's what these apostles were doing and these disciples were doing. That's what the people of the church were doing. These ones here in verse 19 through 21, what were they doing? They were running, right? Because of what? Because of Saul. Boba Fett was after them. They had no idea that Boba Fett turned and now he's a sidekick to Chewbacca and Han Solo. They had no idea that was going on. Okay, I know that didn't happen. Boba Fett died. But let's say he lived through the Sarlacc and came out. Okay. And then he joined Han Solo. They didn't know it. Okay, so they're still running, they're still scattering. It's a good thing because the message of God is spreading and it's going everywhere. Okay, so that's a good thing. But as they're running for their life, what are they doing? Preaching. Some just to the Jews, some to everybody and anybody. Okay, so they're running for their life, they're hiding, they're living under the radar, off the grid, right? They pulled their SIM card off their phone. No one's tracking me, my GPS is off. Okay, they've got burner phones, they got those Visa cash cards so they don't have to have their credit card traced. You know, they're hiding so that Paul can't track them down, or Saul can't track them down, right? So they're hiding, but they're still preaching en route. In other words, their lifestyle is evangelistic. The way they live, it's just they talk about it, and they talk about it all the time. So that leads to a very interesting question. How does one build that evangelistic lifestyle to be like the early church was? To where you're just going, and this is your lifestyle. This is your attitude. This is just what you're about, and this is what you always are just. You can't keep it in. You can't shut it off. This is just who you are. You're a person who shares Jesus, and it becomes so much of a habitual behavior, it might as well be part of your identity. Okay, this is that attitude that we're talking about. How do we build this evangelical lifestyle? So I like looking at how the apostles did it, how Peter did it, how eventually Paul does it. And I like looking at how the disciples and all of them did this. And it's interesting that what we find is that as they're sharing, as they're talking, what we realize, this is really simple, is that they know it and they speak it. I'm going to be real basic. I want to start from the very beginning because I don't want to miss anything. Okay, so they know the gospel and they're speaking it. So they know it. They know what's going on. They know about Jesus. They know that he lived. They know that he died. They know that he rose again. So they know that the gospel is not just about that, because the gospel, Jesus preached it before he ever went to the cross. So the gospel is really about God's kingdom. That's why usually you find the phrase, repent for the kingdom is at hand. But the authors are so, and God is so intent on repeating Jesus that sometimes we forget the whole picture. So it's a good chance for me to remind you it is about God's kingdom, that the gospel is about the restoration of shalom, the restoration of peace, that the gospel is about, that's the good news, that God is going to put down his throne on the new earth, and there will be a new earth, and that everything will be restored, and everything will be redeemed. Isn't that good news? So Jesus preached this before he ever went to the cross, without predicting that he was going to the cross, because of what the gospel was about. And so we get this good news that requires Jesus. Okay, so salvation is Jesus only, and the gospel, this good news, is about what Jesus came and died for, to restore creation with the Creator. And that's predominantly what it's about. And so we need to know and be able to speak the gospel. And when we speak the gospel, we're going to have to be clear, concise. We don't need to tell a 10-hour story. Okay, a lot of the passages, when we read them, they weren't that long. Okay, and the average person today doesn't have a very long attention span. I applaud you guys for making it through our sermons here. But a lot of people, they aren't going to sit there for a half hour letting you tell a story. You probably got 5 minutes. Okay, and if you're going to have something last longer than 5 minutes, then you're going to have to be conversational. It's going to have to be give and take on the issue. You're going to have to talk, and they're going to have to talk, and you're going to have to talk, and they're going to have to talk. You're going to have a conversation if you're going to last more than 5 minutes. So I'm going to listen to you tell a story for 5 minutes, but then they're going to have to speak. There's going to have to be give and take on that. And so it's going to have to be conversational. I love that half the time we see Peter and Paul later, but half the time we see this, we see them giving and taking. They're discussing. They're dialoguing. They're debating at times. And then they ask Peter a question. He said, well, since you asked the question, let me give you the answer. And then he goes for a five-minute spiel, and then they talk some more. Okay, so it's very, very, very conversational. And to help us figure out how to do this, I have a whole different question for you then. Something to really ponder in your mind and to challenge you with, and it goes like this. What are you evangelistic about other than the gospel? Other than Jesus, not talking about anything biblical at all. What are you evangelistic about? What is that? Those things that you talk about with passion and conviction and energy and gusto. Maybe it's a movie. Maybe you saw Jurassic World and you're just geeked about it. And everybody's got to see this movie because it made me feel like an 8-year-old again. And you're just so geeked. Now that was actually a phrase I saw on Facebook, by the way. Someone said it made them feel like an 8-year-old again. Then I felt like an old guy because I was graduating high school when the first Jurassic Park came out. And so I was like, oh man, I wasn't 8, I was 17. Oh man, I feel so old. But nonetheless, some people, they're evangelistic about a movie. You got to see this movie. Or a TV show. Man, you got to see this show. Well, I don't watch that show. I've never seen it. How could you not have seen it? You got to see this. This is so good. You can't believe. And I see people talking about that way, about like Wayward Pines. And they're like, oh my word, this is so good. You got to see this show. I see comments on Facebook from time to time. There are people that are evangelistic the opposite way. Don't see that. What's wrong with you? And they're trying to do the opposite. You need repentance. Don't watch anything that has the word American in the title. American Idol, America's Got Talent, America. Just get away from the reality junk. Just go to real TV programming here. And people evangelize that way. And some people evangelize about their grandkids. You know who you are. You can't go 10 minutes without talking about them. It's just going to come up, right? So you know who you are. Some people are that way about sports. You start talking to them, and within 5 minutes, 10 minutes, that's coming into the conversation. It just naturally is there because you're evangelistic about it. You gotta share. You gotta get it out there. It's something that you kind of view yourself as an expert on because you can quote sports stats. You can quote the director. You can quote writers. You can quote your child's shoe size or your grandchildren's hobbies and expertise and GPA. You can quote whatever the case may be. But what are you evangelistic about, that you view yourself as an expert on, that you have the confidence to just shout it out, speak your mind, and let it get out there? And if somebody totally disagrees with you, that's fine, because you know deep down inside they're ignorant. You got that confidence. You come at it from almost a biased point of view. Even if someone were to tell you why your favorite show was stupid, you would say, well, that's okay. Sure, that part's a little weak, but I still like the show. And you just come at it with that type of boldness. Okay, well, my child has a higher GPA than you, but that's okay. My child's still a genius in more practical ways than your ignorant child. We have that bias, right? Okay, and so we understand that that's... We evangelize it. We get it out there. We defend it. We speak it. Unashamed, unafraid, and out it goes. Ever had the best meal you've ever had and got to tell somebody how great that meal was? Ever evangelize about your spouse to other people? I got the best hubby ever. I got the best wife ever. She just did. You ever don't? How happy is your marriage? I'm telling you, nothing makes a happier message than when a wife can look at her husband and say, hey, they're sexy, and mean it. I'm telling you, that can make a happy home right there, okay? Or when a husband can look at his wife and say, hey, they're gorgeous, and mean it, and not be sarcastic, you can get yourself some happy moments there, can't you? Anyways, moving on. So what are you evangelistic about? Okay, what are you evangelistic about? Now, with that in mind, put it in your head. What is it that you just love talking about? Maybe it's politics. Maybe it's whatever, legal issues, maybe it's school, maybe it's friends, whatever it is, okay? Maybe you're one of those people that are always on Twitter and you always got what Jay-Z posted last week and on it goes. Whatever the case is, whatever you're, you know, write it down if you don't want to forget. Keep that in your mind. And I want you to notice something else. I would love to be able to say, be that way about Jesus. I would love to be able to say that. I would love to be able to say, well, when it comes to the gospel, just like you are with Starbucks, be that way about the Savior. Just as you are about Walmart, be that way about our wonderful Creator. Just as you are about whatever you're evangelistic about and you just got to share about, be that way about Jesus. I would love to be able to say those words. And I would be right in saying those words, but I would also be naive. Because in reality, talking about Jesus is more difficult, isn't it? There's something about it. Talking about Jesus is ultimately, and to some degree, more difficult than movies, kids, sports, etc. Ultimately, it's more difficult. And people have been trying to figure out why. Barna's done research. Pew has done research. Other pastors and theologians and professors and scholars have done research trying to figure this out. And they've come up with theories that have fallen short time and time again. Well, maybe it's harder because it's more personal. I'll tell you what, how personal are grandkids to the grandparent? Yet they're evangelistic about that. Okay, so don't tell me that it's just because it's more personal that that means that that's the issue here. Because we talk about very personal things. Politics, how passionate are some people about politics and they evangelize about it, and how personal is that? For some people, that is very deeply personal. Okay, so there's a lot of personal things that we can be very evangelistic about. So it's not because it's more personal. And people say, well, maybe because it's more about the dead center of our worldview. And that might be true, but a lot of our beliefs on different things are also part of our core of our worldview. We hold it very close and significant and protected. So I don't necessarily buy that as just the only answer. Some people say, well, we're afraid of being rejected. Well, we could get rejected about the movie we like. In fact, just earlier today, I was talking with our sound guy about a movie that I thought was great. I said, hey, I saw this movie. I thought it was great. I think you should watch it. And he said, you liked that? Oh, you saw it? It was horrible. What's wrong with you? Why do you say it was horrible? I thought it was funny. I thought it was trash. And that was just this morning. Okay, great way to come into the service. Okay, and so it was, and that's okay. Our sound guy can be wrong, and I don't mind. But here's... getting beat up later. But here's the thing. Okay, I got rejected, slammed hard. And it's all right. So it's some people say, well, maybe because we're afraid of rejection, but we get rejected on other issues. Some people say maybe we're afraid of being isolated. Well, we can get isolated on other issues as well. And so on and on we go. Maybe we're afraid of the historical stigma that's attached to it. Well, you know what? I liked Bear in the Big Blue House. I like some child programming and still find it engaging and challenging. Give me Roly Poly Oly. Okay, there I got stigma, but I said it and it's on YouTube. Okay, and so it's... that's not the issue. There's more that's going on. And maybe it's the whole ball of wax. Maybe because it's everything and it's a perfect storm. Or maybe, just maybe, and I'm not saying that the answer I'm going to give is the answer. It could also fall short on some things. But I'm wondering if there's something else going on that is breaking apart our evangelistic lifestyle. And if maybe we can put our finger a little more on it, we can deal with it a little differently. And here's what I think is going on, and this is fascinating. I shared this in one of the classes that I teach in the classroom at the college campus, and the students were like, oh, man, they really wanted to ponder on that for a while. Some even came up to me during break, and they said, you know, that really just revolutionized everything I thought about evangelism. And so it was very fascinating. So I'm going to just share this with you and see if you happen to have the same result or if you go, really? Really? Pastor Search Committee, let's meet. Come on, come on. Okay, well, we'll see how this goes. But here's what I think is also going on and one of the roots of the problem here. I don't think it's the only issue. I think there's many other things. This is not exclusive. It is not comprehensive, but I think it's definitely an issue. And that is we do not have a common ground with non-Christians when it comes to Jesus. Here's what I mean by not having a common ground. when it would be like this. Let's say I were to talk to you. I'm watching the show on TV. It's called Wayward Pines. I mentioned it earlier. I happen to kind of like it. Okay, I'm an M. Night Shyamalan fan. I liked all the movies he did. The Happening was probably the worst of his films, but I still enjoyed parts of it. And a lot of people say, really, you have a film major and you like M. Night Shyamalan. What's wrong with you? His movies are trash. I'm like, well, here I am, fanboy. I watched Wayward Pines episode 1 just because he directed it and produced it, okay? So I was on board just because his name was there. And I really liked it. Of course, I'm biased. I like his work, so I'm going to like it just because he did it. But I liked it. I really did like it. Now, if I were to try to evangelize the show to someone, if I were to try to make a convert or if I were to proselytize someone to be a viewer of this show, and I go up to them and I say, you know, hey, I saw this show, and I think you might really like it. It was a great show. It's called Wayward Pines. And then the person were to say, I don't own a TV. I've never owned a TV. What does that do to the conversation at that point? It kills it. Am I going to talk about The Price is Right with this person? Am I going to talk about Whose Line Is It Anyways? Am I going to talk about, you know, CSI being canceled? Am I going to talk about hey, NCIS is coming back, 12th year, woo. You know, am I going to talk about any of that? No. Why? We don't have a common ground. When we're going to non-Christians, guess what we don't have when it comes to Jesus? We do not have a common ground. We are coming at it, talking to someone about Jesus is like talking to someone about a TV show when they don't even have a TV. They don't have a cell phone. They don't have internet. And okay, this is what we're dealing with. Why is it that talking about Jesus is so much more difficult? Because that's where we're coming from. A totally uncommon, unrelated ground. What that means then is that we're going to have to take a whole different approach. What we're going to have to do is find common ground on something else and then segue it to be about Jesus. You see the difference of approach there? This is not, hi, I was wondering if you died today, would you go to heaven? This is not that type of a thing. It is not that strict, simple initiation of a conversation. Okay, because you think about it. Hi there, if you were to die today, would you regret watching Wayward Pines? You know, we don't have TVs here. Close. What's wrong with you? Okay, we can't just go that approach like that anymore because we don't have this common ground like that. And the knowledge of Jesus is becoming significantly less. We are actually able to run. It was back in the 80s, it was really hard to find somebody who hadn't at least heard the name Jesus Christ. Okay, a lot of people at least knew of Christianity because of the impact of the church upon the culture of our society. That has so changed over the past 30 years. In fact, not that long ago, we had a block party over at, I think it was the Alpine Slopes area, York Creek Apartments. Okay, we were at York Creek Apartments, and I ran across she looked like she might have been Hispanic. She had that look about her. So I thought she was a Hispanic lady, and I'm talking with her, and she wanted to know what we're doing. And I said, well, we're part of this church. We're part of Anchor, and we're doing this. And she goes, how much are the rides? I said, it's free. She goes, why is it free? I said, well, you see, God gave us Jesus for free, and Jesus loves us, and we want to give his love out for free. And she said, why is this all about my cousin? And I looked at her, and I was like, I thought she was pulling my leg. I thought she was joking me. And I go, what do you mean your cousin? Well, Jesus. Or she goes, we're Spanish, so it's Jesus. Why would my cousin be about this? What do you mean God sent him? Are you high? She never heard. Had no idea who I was talking about. You know, and then I had to start from scratch. I'm like, well, no, I'm talking about God. God the Father, God the Son, Jesus Christ. She goes, it's not his last name. And I'm like, no, not your cousin. And then we had to sit down. And her friends came over, saw us talking, asked what we were talking about. She said, he's talking about, apparently someone has the same name as my cousin. And I told them about Jesus. And they said, oh, I heard about him in catechism when I was a kid, but I just drowned all that out. Their friends had heard the name but knew nothing about anything. Okay, so we had a hard, awkward conversation. And I was taken aback. I was just so confused by this whole thing. And so what we end up having to do now is when we come across people that we have not that common ground with, We have nothing to work with, nothing to start from. We're going to have to find common ground, either in a movie or sports or hunting or fishing or kids or politics, something. We're going to have to find common ground somewhere, and then we're going to have to develop and use a segue. Maybe not that type of segue, but we're going to have to develop a segue to move from that normal conversation, if you will, to a spiritual conversation to where we can eventually talk about Jesus. And I say spiritual conversation because it doesn't mean we segue right from, oh, really, you like baseball? I love baseball. And every time somebody slides across home plate, it just and they're pronounced safe, it makes me think about Jesus and whether I'm safe or not and his love and care and how he died and rose again. And that's not a segue. That's making someone think you're nuts and something's wrong with you. Okay, we gotta really get into the idea of something spiritual and then bring how Jesus is the answer to that question. Well, I love looking through like how Paul used to do this. Paul was amazing at this. In Acts chapter 17, Paul is walking around and he's looking at all the idols that are there and he's seeing everything and he ends up talking to leaders. He talks to religious leaders and secular political leaders. Essentially, he goes to Grand Valley State University and then Calvin College and Christian leaders. Then Cornerstone. And just kidding. I know, bad slam. But anyway, Paul's talking to religious leaders, secular leaders, okay? And he's like, I see all that you got here. I see that you guys are very religious people. And I see the shrines that you've built and the statues you've built and all these things. I see the poetry. You guys got some nice stuff here. I noticed on one of them, it said to an unknown God. And you've been kind of curious about what I've been talking to people about. Well, I happen to know this God that to you is unknown. He never talks about Jesus right away. In fact, he doesn't talk about Jesus in that sermon really at all. The name's not there. The only time he talks about Jesus is after the conversation is done. Some of them mocked, some of them rejected him. Some of them were curious about information and more academic issues. Some of them followed him, where then he shared Jesus and then they became saved. Okay, so what he did was is he started with a conversation about their culture and their architecture and their artwork. And then he made an observation about how they were kind of saying that there's something out there somewhere. And he says, you know what? I happen to know what's out there. I happen to know what's somewhere. And then he leaves. And some of them say, hey, what is this? And he shares Jesus with them at that point. But he segued it. Okay, so I would like for us to learn a little bit, just the 101 of how do we develop and use a segue. And there's really, in a sense, you can categorically say that there's two types of segues. There's what's called the cultural situation segue. That's what Paul did as he's looking at the culture around him and then using it to segue from a regular conversation to a spiritual conversation from which you can eventually share Jesus into. Okay, so that's a cultural situational segue, using a movie, using sports, using artwork, using whatever the case is. But then there's also the personal situation segue. And the personal situation segue is where you use something that you can relate to personally. Someone shares a story of suffering and pain, and you've been through that. And then you can use that to dialogue and relate to the person with that common ground and then segue into what God has done in your life to initiate a spiritual conversation to be able to eventually talk about Jesus. Let me give you an example of each for you that I've actually used within the past month. I had like dozens of ideas, and I just want to share the ones that I've used recently that have been, at least for the most part, very successful and are great examples of these. And successful, not that they became saved, because they did not, but we engaged into the dialogue. We got there. It wasn't just, how's the weather? I like that movie too. It got to talking about God, the existence of God. And even in one case, with the personal one that I used, we even talked about Jesus. We got there. And then the goal is to get there. And then if they accept Jesus or not, that's between them and the Holy Spirit at that point. Because it's the Holy Spirit that convicts. It's the Holy Spirit that gives the words powers and effectiveness. It's the Holy Spirit that redeems and restores. It's the Holy Spirit that's involved in that. So we got to just be the message and get it out there with as much love and compassion as we possibly can. So a cultural segue, cultural situational segue that I used recently was involving a movie that I didn't even like all that much. It was called Alice in Wonderland by Tim Burton, with Johnny Depp as the Mad Hatter. Okay, so we're watching this movie, and I've seen this movie, and I was talking with some people about this movie. So we're talking about Alice in Wonderland, and they're like, oh man, Tim Burton has such a great eye for it. And I'm like, you know, man, that movie, I just didn't like it as well as I liked the Disney cartoon. And so we're talking about, you know, why we thought the cartoon was better or not better than the movie. And I pointed out, my time for my segue has come. And so I decided I wanted to segue into this a little bit, into a spiritual conversation. That's the only reason one of the reasons I got into this dialogue in the first place. Anyone who rejects the cartoon is high. So the segue was, I'm talking, I said, you know what I really liked best about the cartoon? And they said, what? I said, I really loved that bong-smoking caterpillar. And of course, people were like, what? You know, you like that bong-smoking caterpillar? You know what I'm talking about, right? The you know, he would blow smoke in the shape of, you know, things. It would, you know, really fun little like scissors and alligator jaws and all this. So I'm like, I love the bong-smoking caterpillar. And one of the things he asked, I found so insightful. He ends up going to Alice and he spits smoke in her face. It sounds very misogynist, but it's not. And I'm like, and he tells her, asks her the question, who are you? I'm like, what a great question. And they're like, she's Alice. I'm like, hey, let me explain. That's literally what the reply back. She's Alice. That was stupid. I'm like, well, think about it. Who is she? Who are you? If you were to change your name, does that change who you are? You know, who are you? If you say that, you try to define who you are, and you do that by saying, I have this job, I'm a parent, I'm a son, I'm an employee, yeah, that's who I am. But if that were to change for some reason, the parent were to die, the job were to fire you, and you were to, whatever were to happen, does that change you? I understand that it has psychological impact and that we have that type of fluidity, but you as a person, are you still you? When those changes come, they're like, well, yeah. I said, so then the caterpillar asks, who are you? You see what we're able to start doing now? We're able to get something more toward a spiritual realm of things. We started talking about where do we get our identity from? What do I eventually get to share? Identity in Christ. Okay, see, it's getting it to that deeper level. That's a cultural type of segue. And you see that and it was conversational. I didn't give a sermon. I just asked, who are you as a caterpillar? I explained why I found it philosophically engaging, and I let it go for a while. And we talked for a while. Okay, so that was a very, on a personal one, for a personal segue, this one's a lot more intense. This was when we were at the Deltaplex for our food fair. So this is last month, so when I say within last month, I'm right on the wire, but I'm there. Okay, so when we're at the Deltaplex, I love this example and this illustration of a personal segue. I was looking at, there's this worker that was working, and she was just working her butt off, helping us out as she's getting this taken care of and that taken care of and all these things are going on. And I looked at her face, and she looked tired. Okay, but it wasn't like exhausted, I woke up early in the morning tired. It looked like she had that downed countenance. You know what I'm talking about? You can tell when someone's more than just bags under their eyes because they woke up early and went to bed late because they partied. You're talking something that just looks heavy upon the person. Maybe it's the moving of the Holy Spirit. Maybe it's any number of things. Because by the way, if you're going to use segues, that's exactly who you need to rely upon. You need very much to rely on the Holy Spirit to present to you and bring to you the opportunity to make it aware to you, and then you have to have the boldness through the power of the Holy Spirit to take advantage of that opportunity. Okay, so you have to be real sensitive and real open to it, because you never know when it's going to come. It's not like you can just say, okay, Lord, okay, Holy Spirit, and Lord, at 2:30, I would love an opportunity to You know, it's not going to be like that. It's going to come when you least expect it. And during a food fair, when we're all going nuts trying to get stuff put together, okay, and this is like when this segue happens, this is before the actual food fair. It's the night before. Okay, when we're trying to set everything up and get everything going. So I see this woman, and she's, you know, working next to this high-low type machine. I'm so engineer competent. And so she's next to this machine thing, and I walk up to her, and I just said, you know, man, it looks like it's been a long week for you. And she started telling me a story. She first, before she started speaking, when I said that, she just kind of, she paused for a moment and gave a breath, almost like a gasp. Just, and then she looked down for a little bit, and then she looked at me. She started telling me the story about her son and what a challenge he is. Apparently, her son was born with a type of mental or brain damage, some type of severe mental impairment, and that there are days or even weeks to where he's more difficult to handle than others. And she was just burdened. She was heavy. She's like, and people are calling in sick because, you know, they got some little problem here at home or whatever. And she's like, but I'm here. And I have this real big issue, and it's not going to go away. And yet I'm here at work. And she's like, and I'm stretched, and I'm hurting, and I'm struggling. And she just was telling me about her son and what made it so difficult. And what she didn't know is how much I can relate. She didn't know that I have a brother who was born with about the most severe brain damage you can have and still be alive as a human being. She didn't know that I grew up with a brother in that type of way, that I grew up changing my older brother's diapers and all the way even through high school when he's an adult and I'm changing his diapers. She had no idea that I grew up with that type of a brother, that I understood what it meant to have to struggle with someone's existence, what it means to love someone that can't love you back, what it means to have to give from someone who can only take, what it means to have that type of a lifestyle that's never going to really end like that. He's always going to be there. And so she didn't know. And I didn't have to even share right away. I was able to take that personal situation of my own, hear where she's at, recognize that as common ground, and I could segue it right away. And I did an immediate segue. And I didn't plan on it. It just, the Holy Spirit was just using this moment in a very amazing way. And she's telling me this story, and when she got done, and she just did that. And that's when all of a sudden I had this phrase. It was from a song that I remember hearing long, long time ago. And I just said this phrase. I said, you know, sometimes blessings are wrapped in disguise. That's all it was. Sometimes blessings are wrapped in disguise. And then she looked up at me and she said, you know, that's so true. And she started telling me about the joy she's had of having him as a son versus any other type of son. She started telling me the moments of glimpses of brilliance that she sees in him when he's able to figure, yeah, sure, other kids can figure it out, but he figured it out this way. And she started suddenly explaining how much of a blessing he's been to her. We started talking about how God can bring about so many blessings from so many dark places and what it means that God does that for us, and we can see that. And sometimes life gets so heavy and so stressful and so dark, and then out of nowhere, God just brings this breath of life into it and shows us something amazing. And she's like, you know, I've been sensing that yeah, God, something out there is really trying to, really has blessed me with this son. And we started talking more about that. And she started recognizing the existence of God and that God hadn't abandoned her with a disabled child. No, God has blessed her with a bundle of joy. And when we got done with our conversation, she had this look on her face that was no longer of being burdened. She had this look on her face of having a new fresh air, a second wind, a new life. And she started talking to me how you know, she'd been to church in the past, but hasn't been as faithful as what she should be, and she really needs to start looking at a whole chance of a new revival was happening within her because of the Holy Spirit and a segue. This is where we come in. This is what we need to be doing when we run across people. You open up a conversation. You build a common ground. And then you can segue it right in to talking about God and talking about the love of Jesus. You can segue it right into that. You can speak grace into the lives of others. And if ever we're going to do that, because here's the thing, the people you bump into, they're entrusted to you. God has entrusted that person to you because who bumped into that person? You did. So it's up to you. You have that opportunity. You have the availability. You have that moment to take advantage to speak grace in the life of someone. And just maybe, yes, maybe, like with Paul, some might laugh and scoff and reject. Some might, you know, talk just for a further conversation. But some might just follow Jesus. Some might just want that in their life and seek it and accept it and have it change everything. I want you guys, throughout this week, ask the Holy Spirit to help you be sensitive to opportunities. To help you be sensitive to moments that can come out of nowhere. Ask the Holy Spirit to do that. And then to fill you with boldness to not let it go. But to take advantage of it. To be able to take that moment and to speak grace into their life. Ask that for this week. That as we go, we can do that.